probably a three.
First fist of the day for you. You haven't been here for an hour, have you?
No, not even. I popped one other one off. That was probably like a 4-pounder. And I had another one smack me, and this guy came back. I think it was the same one, honestly. Probably about a 3-pounder, though.
Wow.
Fat.
Opening day in Braidwood. Got a little bit of snow. And Southside is calm as can be. Great stuff. Hey, guys. Welcome to another episode of Fishland West. I'm your host, John B. I'm out on opening day in Braidwood near Cole City. And this is the first bass of the March season, spring season. It's a heat discharge lake, and you get a lot of fish that stay active all year round, including largemouth and smallmouth, and this is the first one today. Caught that one on a chartreuse blackback, Stanford Cedar Lures 1.5, throwing on a 7-foot Lures Hero. Nothing huge, really got that 3-pounder. Seen some other fish being caught lately, but I just want to turn on the cameras to show you the first fish of the year. It's a little snow bass, an icicle fish. Get back with you guys once we get some more. Was originally going to go out in the boat today, but plans fell through, so I decided just to come down here at the very least and bank fish. And this lake's it's a pretty good lake, you know. It's got the size. It's sometimes hard to pin down the numbers, but the size is here. They're good quality fish. They're all healthy fish. We've got some largemouth. Kind of uncommon to catch a smallmouth here, but I've seen some pretty good smallmouth being pulled out of these waters. Today I'm just working on staying in the water column as to where those fish are hanging out. The key really isn't figuring out what they're biting on. I know what they're biting on. I know the general location as to where they're at, but it's the really key point in today of fishing is maintaining, keeping my lure in the strike zone for the most part. It's actually pretty difficult, especially if you're throwing a crankbait, and I don't have a whole lot of variety crankbaits, being that I don't have a extremely large amount of money to spend on a variety of different depths and stuff like that. So I'm throwing a 1.5 style bait. It dives to 3 to 5 feet, and I'm trying to keep my rod in a position where it's just barely hovering over those rocks. I don't get a whole lot of bites banging off the rocks, which seems kind of unorthodox, especially for springtime fishing, but the water temperature is a lot warmer than the air temp. Of course, air temp is 20 degrees, and the water temp over here is in the mid to low 60s. And I could be throwing a jig right now, but I just don't think that they're relating too heavily on the bottom. I think they're out moving around. You know, I've seen a lot of fat fish, possibly full of shad, possibly full of eggs, so you don't know. So that's just kind of keeping it going right now. The equipment I'm using a 7-foot American Hero Speed Stick Lose and a Shimano Corrado 200 G7. It's a G6 actually. It's got the 6.5:1. I like a little bit of faster gear ratio if I do have to move that crankbait a little bit faster than need be. And I'm throwing 14-pound test FC Sunline Reaction Fluorocarbon. And it's getting the job done so far. I haven't even been here for, maybe it's probably been a full hour now, but I've already got one fish. Blaze caught a nice one. And like I said, I've been seeing some people around here doing some good work. But with the snow coming down, the calm waters, I think this is kind of creating a cool little environment for me to fish. And it's good just kind of get out in the water and cast a rod that's over 24 inches. Bite has slowed down significantly right now. Haven't even gotten a mere sign of a fish in the past 2 hours. Bite slowed down for everyone though, for the most part. You know, I kind of processed and I thought about what kind of went wrong today. Granted, I'm not giving up. I'm still going to fish for a couple more hours. But I'm just kind of processing in my mind what I could have done better. And the thing is, with a lake like this, like Braidwood, that's heavy in shad, heavy in bass that feed in shad, you've got to hit the right times. You've got a gateway, you've got a small to medium-sized gateways to where you can catch these fish when they're feeding on bait fish, on shad. And that's kind of the main problem when you're fishing a lake like this. And it can also help you as well. So let's say, you know, you get in the water around 7 o'clock, 6 a.m., something like that, and you're just crushing them on crankbaits. And you're just kind of going along and you're thinking you're getting a pattern together. You're thinking that you're catching them in a spot that you can go back to at the end of the day. But in reality, these bass are just chasing these shad that are sprawled out along a long strip like this that's full of riprap and rock. You know, about 15, 20 yards off of the riprap, it's about 7 feet. A little bit closer, it gets into 5, and right at the bank, it's about 2 to 3. And a lot of the shad sit in that 5 foot range. You kind of have to follow the bass because they're not just going to be busting on shad in one area. Shad are going to try to escape the bass. So, you know, they're not going to run in circles in one area, and that'd be too convenient, of course. They're going to be moving along the bank, moving with the wind, trying to avoid the largemouth, and the largemouth will be following them right behind. If you know that they're feeding on shad, if you're catching them on crankbaits, keep fishing different areas. Don't keep fishing the same area. So let's say, you know, you get three and after like 10 casts, there's nothing else, keep moving on. It's one of those fast-paced bites, especially because when these fish feed on shad, it takes up a lot of energy, and this is science for the most part. They use up a lot of oxygen, a lot of energy is depleted, and by doing so, it just creates, it's not like they're feeding on craws. And while, yes, these shad are high in protein and they're easily digested, it still takes up a lot of oxygen energy for these fish, so they're not going to be doing this all throughout the day. You're not going to find the same, you know, the one bass isn't going to keep on feeding on shad throughout the entire day. You know, it's possible, it may happen, but especially when the water temperature is high and the oxygen levels are depleted, and you know, the warmer the water, the lower dissolved oxygen, and the colder the water, the more dissolved oxygen there is. But on a heat discharge like this, where a power plant is, when the water's hot, these fish aren't going to feed all throughout the day. You're going to have dead zones, and I'm experiencing one of those dead zones right now. I've pulled out the deeper right here, and I kind of just looked at some of the depths and to see if I could see any schooling bait fish or fish. You know, there's some schooling bait fish, but there's nothing really behind them. So, I mean, once the fish gets their fill, they're kind of done. They get their fill. They may feed later on in the day, but there's always going to be a little bit of gap. It may not be long, it may not be short, but there's going to be a gap, and sometimes you might hit that gap. But like I said, the main thing that I had problems with today was moving with the groove. I wasn't really, you know, moving along the riprap. I was fishing too long in one area. Especially when the fish are feeding like this, you have to follow them. You're just kind of walking in their shadow, walking in their footsteps, and you're seeing what they're doing. You're seeing the direction the shad are going, the bait fish are going, and you're utilizing that to catch some of these fish. And I mean, the fish were there was a solid pattern for, you know, about 2 or 3 hours, and it stopped. And they weren't hugging the riprap, but they were close to the riprap. And they weren't noticeably busting on the shad, but they were definitely feeding on shad. And there was a lot more activity on top of the water a couple hours early. So I'm going to give a couple more shots. I think I'm done with the crankbait, though. It may pick up here in a little bit, but for the most part, I don't know. I think this day seems about done. All right, so I just popped another one off camera. You know, I was talking about how I needed to abandon that reaction bite, and I did, and it seemed to pay off. This is the second fish I've caught on the on this shaky head right here. All I'm doing right now is I'm throwing a little Gamagatsu shaky head with trickworm. Trickworms are pretty inexpensive. They catch fish, and they've got some good colors. Not a bad fish. It's my third one of the day, second keeper, and I'm gonna put her back in the water for some more.